The Southeast is home to some of the most beautiful snakes in the world, and this is your chance to see many of them up close. But there are concerns about species at risk, including one of the largest snakes in North America.
It is no surprise there are many people who don't like snakes. They're not warm and fuzzy. Some, like the coral snake, are venomous with a bite that can be deadly. But most snakes just want to get out of your way. If you put your fears aside, there is no denying the beauty. This is like moving art. The markings can be stunning. Some of the designs provide a perfect camouflage. Snakes are covered with scales and have no limbs. Yet, they can climb trees, swim across lakes, and cover miles of territory. They have muscles along their body, and those muscles contract quickly from right to left, then left to right, making it look like they're gliding across the ground. We met Whit Gibbons, co-author of a book on snakes and professor of ecology at UGA's Savannah River Ecology Lab near Augusta. Gibbons says these reptiles are not harmful if you leave them alone.
There's nothing to fear about most snakes, and you have to be careful. It's like dealing with electricity. We all use electricity, and it can kill us if we don't use it right. You don't pick up a rattlesnake. You don't pester it. I've met several people that have missing limbs, or digits rather, and have scars from trying to kill a diamondback rattlesnake that was going down a hole. And these people tried to kill it, and they didn't have to. They chased it, and it turned around and bit them.
This corn snake could bite me, but they tend to be docile. It is a common snake that is absolutely gorgeous, and it can be found throughout the Southeast. It gets the name corn snake in part because of the unique design on its belly, which is said to look like Indian corn. It is also known to hang around corn bins since it feeds on rats and mice.
Any knowledgeable farmer, I've talked to many of them in Georgia, they're not going to kill a corn snake or a rat snake. They know they're out there doing a job they don't have to do.
Corn snakes are a species of rat snake, and rat snakes are found in several colors in several climates. They are major predators in the animal world, and without them, we would see a huge increase in the rodent population. King snakes are equally important in keeping the ecosystem balanced.
King snakes will eat a wide variety of animals. They'll eat other snakes, including the venomous species, and they are immune to the venom of the pit vipers, copperheads, rattlesnakes, cottonmouths. A king snake can eat one of those. If the pit viper bites the king snake, it's okay. It's immune to the venom. It won't kill it. It'll just constrict it, kill the rattlesnake, say, turn around and eat it.
There is another snake that eats venomous snakes. This is Drymarchan cooperi. In Latin, Drymarchan roughly translates into Lord of the Forest, Ruler, Commander. A powerful name for something that doesn't roar or stampede through the jungle. But this is no ordinary snake. Zoologist Dirk Stevens first introduced me to this massive snake.
Why is this such an important species to this part of Georgia?
The indigo is a remarkable snake, and it's an iconic, handsome snake. As you can see, it is the longest snake in North America. The record is over 8.5 feet. This is not a full-grown indigo male by any stretch of the imagination. They come much, much bigger. And it really captures the wilderness of southern Georgia. Places where indigos still occur tend to be very wild, vast, undisturbed habitats.
They like to eat venomous snakes. So much so that when indigos disappeared from Alabama, copperhead snakes increased significantly.
They find the snakes and they rapidly crawl up to their head and chew on their head and kill them, and then they swallow them head first. In the ecology of these habitats, they really put a hurting on vipers and other venomous snakes.
Indigos used to be common in the Southeast, but as you can see from this map, their populations are getting squeezed out. They can still be found on land like the Mopani Preserve, owned by the Orian Society. Orian is a wildlife conservation organization that focuses primarily on snakes and owns close to 3,000 acres dedicated to restoring indigos throughout the South. Because, as Orian CEO Chris Jenkins explains, indigos need a lot of space.
So I like to think about indigo snakes as kind of the tigers of the snake world, if you will, meaning that they are this large, very mobile predator that's moving across a huge landscape looking for food. And there have been studies that have found, you know, that these animals will use over 1,000 acres in their home range within a year, which means this entire property that we're on, you know, is smaller than the area that one individual indigo snake might use in a given year.
Indigo snakes need different types of terrain. They like bottomland forests and swamps to hunt for food in the summer. But in winter, they head for the ancient sand ridges that define the coastal plain. Gopher tortoises, another species in decline, need these sandy landscapes as well. The snakes use the tortoise holes to mate and spend the winter. Both species are in trouble because this kind of land is also threatened. Magnificent longleaf pines once covered large areas of the United States, starting in southern Virginia and stretching all the way west to Texas. This is what the early explorers saw when they passed through this region. But like indigo snake populations, that vast expanse of forest land is just a shadow of its former self. We have lost 97% of the longleaf pine ecosystem. What you see left is a very optimistic view. Most experts believe there is even less longleaf forest than is shown here. In a short while, some of this land will be set on fire. It's part of a multi-state, multi-agency effort to restore longleaf pine habitat, because it doesn't do much good to save this guy if he doesn't have any place to live. 2 years after our first visit, we came back to Mopani, where hardwood trees are gradually being replaced with longleaf pines. Early one August morning, we meet Mopani land manager Wayne Taylor on property that will be planted with longleaf.
Sharon and I are going to be together most of the day, so my usual role of being the patrol backup will probably be compromised somewhat.
Are you insinuating that you have to babysit me?
No, I just have to make special adjustments to the operation to accommodate you.
Lightning used to bring flames to this land, keeping it clear. But these days, forest fires are extinguished. Hardwoods and dense vegetation crowd the longleaf pines. The only way to get rid of any competition is to set it on fire.
You were throwing that fire mighty close to yourself. You're gonna burn 35 acres today, right?
That's right. This is part of a 520-acre longleaf restoration project that all of these hills that were cleared for pasture are gonna be planted in longleaf this fall. The first stage is burning.
We walk a line with fuel and flames shooting from a drip torch, setting fire around the perimeter of 35 acres. Longleaf pines thrive in fire. They need open space to grow.
It's notable that longleaf promotes fire through the high resin content, the needles, and as part of that process, it really needs fire this time of the year to create a seed bed for when the seeds fall in November. So a fire occurring this time of the year cleans the surface, prepares the seed bed for the seed catch in the fall for the longleaf, plus it maintains this open condition so that the seedlings can have plenty of space to grow and not be shaded out from competition.
Leaving the burn, we spot a huge eastern diamondback rattlesnake. She is captured, measured, and has a pit tag installed so they can identify her if she is ever spotted again. It's the only way to keep track of snake populations.
Mark it about there.
You do not want to do something like this if you don't know what you're doing.
These needles come preloaded, so the chip is already inside.
She'll be returned to the place they found her, but right now, this is one angry snake. Months later, here is the land you saw burning. It is fresh with flowers, grasses, and a wide swath to plant longleaf pines in the very place where they were meant to be. Another part of the effort to boost the indigo population involves eggs taken from Georgia snakes, which then go to Auburn University in Alabama. They are kept there until they hatch. Watch where the egg dimples a bit. The babies rarely pop right out. They sit a while before emerging. Then they go to Zoo Atlanta, where they're closely guarded in this room for 18 to 24 months.
So what we do is we keep them in these tubs. That way we can keep each snake individually, because as you probably know about indigo snakes, one of their favorite foods is snakes. And they will eat each other from time to time. Some people
think it's even after one snake pops out of his drawer, his tail begins to quiver.
And that's when they get excited, or they're a little nervous, or they're, you know, being intimidated. And when they do that in some dried leaves, it'll actually make a noise very similar to a rattlesnake's rattle. So
Brad Locke is one of the only people who comes in contact with these growing babes. That's to minimize any disease transmission and keep them as wild as possible. Now, don't get grossed out. This is a dead mouse. But we do want you to see how even at this tiny size, indigo snakes have a big appetite.
Wait till he's done with the tail. Okay.
As the babies turn into teenagers, Brad will return them to Alabama.
This is a snake that has actually spent its entire life within the lab, within a cage.
Zoologist Jim Godwin says they realized these lab-controlled snakes need a halfway house before they can be set free.
So we came up with an idea as to how to sort of transition them between this very sterile, limited lab environment to the wild.
After a few weeks, they become more aggressive. Some will strike defensive poses. They prepare for the ultimate test of survival. One misty spring morning, we meet Jim, his students, and a group of snake lovers at Conecuh National Forest in southeast Alabama. A lot of indigos are being released today. Auburn students keep track of which snakes are set free and where they go.
So three is getting P5. Two in this one, two in the next one, one and three. Mm-hmm.
Georgia
and four,
is a huge part of this effort because Alabama's indigo population disappeared.
But we knew that there were good populations in southeast Georgia, and those populations are at about the same latitude as where we are now. And so, you know, our thought process was the snakes that are over there are adapted to the same climate that we have over here. And so we began working with people in Georgia, with Georgia DNR, and then with staff with the Orient Society, which helped us to acquire snakes. This snake is a female. She was born in 2008. She is known as C5.
C5 has been released before, and when recaptured, she laid eggs, so she's a good candidate for boosting the population.
There's an armadillo hole over there, and you think she'll make a beeline for that?
She was, when she was captured a few weeks back, she was near this armadillo hole.
All right, baby girl, go find a safe place. Oh, look at that. She's going right for that hole.
Mm-hmm. The next release is in a fenced area. P5 is a male snake from Georgia, and this is his first time out. He needs a little help finding the gopher tortoise hole.
All right, buddy, now if you can't find this hole now, there you go.
There is such a strong commitment here. Snakes had to be captured in Georgia. Eggs had to hatch at Auburn. Babies spent close to 2 years at Zoo Atlanta.
You want to do the honors?
All for this moment.
And the ultimate goal is that from Alabama, Florida, Georgia, we have one whole population of indigo snakes once again.
Yes. Yes.
It's a big, big project.
It is.
You got faith?
Yes. The snakes are demonstrating that, I think, to that it is possible.
It isn't just the indigo snake that faces population declines.
Just walk by it.
We joined Chris Jenkins and researcher Brian Hudson in search of timber rattlesnakes in the Georgia mountains. You are about to see something rare. Not only are the timber rattlers here, they just had babies. Unlike indigos, rattlesnakes give birth to live young. But to catch them basking on the rocks like this is a special moment. Normally, they would disappear at our approach.
You think they know we're here?
Absolutely, definitely.
Timber rattlesnakes have lived in the Appalachians for thousands of years.
This is really an image of the mountains. The rattlesnake, the timber rattlesnake, is not something that should be feared, but really respected in the sense that, you know, look at the terrain that these survive on. These are fairly incredible animals.
When we get a little too close, Mama lets it be known. A timber rattlesnake bite can be dangerous, but she never strikes, and most will not bite as long as you keep your distance. Timber rattlesnakes must live about a decade before they can reproduce. And even then, they may only have babies twice in an entire lifetime.
When you talk a wild animal surviving 40 years from predation, from food scarcity, from harsh winters, that's really an image of these mountain ranges. That's something that should be preserved as best as can be.
Their whole life history is built for surviving hard times, surviving times when there's not a lot of prey, surviving disturbance. And so one of the actual worst things you can do for a rattlesnake is kill an adult female. Because of that slow life history, they require sometimes living 30, 40 years.
Georgia has one of the highest densities of snakes in the entire U.S. And this is one of the most common.
This is a widespread snake as far as, particularly in Georgia, they're present almost the entire state except for portions of the extreme southeast. When I say abundant, these are snakes that can thrive in a quarter of an acre patch of ivy in the middle of Atlanta.
Copperheads don't have a tail that rattles, but like rattlesnakes, they are pit vipers, which means they have a deep pit between the eye and nostril, which allows them to sense the heat of their prey. Helpful when hunting at night. Snakes are everywhere, a fact many of you probably don't like. But the more you know, the safer you are.
We've been out in kind of the mist and the rain all day looking for timber rattlesnakes, and a lot of people would say we're crazy for doing that.
Mm-hmm.
You get great pleasure from it.
Oh, definitely. To me, it's a, I mean, I love snakes. They're fascinating to me, but I definitely do get a big adrenaline rush getting out into wild places and trying to find a snake like a timber rattlesnake. I mean, if you have timber rattlesnakes, it's a wild place.
Are we really in danger of losing populations of snakes, or maybe on the brink of that because of development, because of all the roads and highways that didn't exist in the past?
I would say the idea of snake populations disappearing is real, and we've seen it. We've seen it in a number of places. So it's not something that we're just speculating on. It's something that we've seen. So we need to be concerned.
My reward for traipsing around rattling rocks all day is a lesson in handling venomous snakes.
The most they can bite is a third to a half of the length of their body. And no matter what, you just always need to keep a distance from a snake and you'll never get a bite.
Chris makes a strong point. Don't fool around trying to hook her. It has to be quick.
They don't want to fall off the hook. Occasionally a snake will, but typically they're going to stay on it. So why don't you just try to pick her up like that?
I'm not going to stab her with this.
No, just slide it under. There you go.
Probably got her a little too low.
No, that's good. She's a heavy snake, you know. In the wild, I'd probably get a copperhead a little bit further forward, but
wow.
she's a heavy snake, so.
Walking around with a copperhead. Now what do I do?
Just set her down gently, just like that.
To Chris Jenkins and others who love snakes, educating the public is critical, or the fight to maintain snake populations is in jeopardy. This is more than just a struggle to save snakes. It is about maintaining icons of the South. There are more than 50 native snake species in our region. Now, you may not like them, but they represent a thread that keeps the Southeast tapestry from unraveling.
Maybe some of you still don't like snakes, but all of those who participated in this show ask one thing, that snakes are valued and respected as much as any other species. I'm Sharon Collins. We'll see you next time.